And so here it runs horizontally, creating a dome-shaped roof over it. And you go into the little circle, the electromagnetic waves run vertically, straight out of the ground, straight into the sky, one giant column up into the sky. Then we go to the bigger ruin at the top. As you approach it in that channel that's only half complete, it starts at like 8, 9, 10, 11. By the time you get here, the heat signature, 8, 9, 10 degrees. By the time you get to the middle, it's 33 degrees Celsius. Outside, 5.5 degrees. 5.5 degrees outside there. When you cross over those two little stone walls, they're only about this high, people. They're nothing to write home about. It goes from 5.5 degrees to 58 degrees. 5.5, 58. What on earth is going on here? Something strange is happening that we don't understand. The electromagnetic waves here, once again, run horizontally, creating a dome-shaped roof. That's why we couldn't do GPR, ground penetrating radar tests. And they completely and utterly failed.
So why you don't have green things inside, things don't grow there?
No, they do grow. We cleared them out. We clear the ruins out so you can take people in there and walk them around. Otherwise, it's completely covered by trees and bushes and weeds. And you can't even see them from the air. Right? And the 580 megahertz volt measurement that we get here. And then we get to Adam's calendar. Everything you think you understand about logical science and measurements just completely flies out the window. There's the imaginary circle. Remember, there's no wall. It's an imaginary circle. As you approach it from over there, the heat signature is about 9 degrees or 9.5 degrees. As you cross this imaginary circle past the stone man that is no longer there, it shoots up to 77 degrees Celsius. 9 degrees, 77 degrees. Weird stuff, people. Then you go between the two calendar stones and it maxes out at 80 degrees Celsius. It stops abruptly. It's moving up and abruptly stops at 80 degrees because that's the maximum it can measure. It's telling you standing on top of a volcano. Clearly there's no volcano. There's Black Reef quartzite full of gold. And then we measure the sound frequencies. Sound frequencies outside, nothing, just a few ambient sounds and noises that we pick up. The moment you cross that imaginary line, it maxes out and stops abruptly at 375 gigahertz. It's insane. At about, I think it's at about 105 dB. I'll just check on that, but I think it's 105, which is extremely loud.
It's like traffic.
It's very loud. I mean, it's like almost eardrum damage. It's the highest frequency allocated in the USA is 300 gigahertz. This thing stops abruptly at 375. It tells it's still going up. What's going on? And then the electromagnetic waves, as you cross in the imaginary circle, it shoots up from nothing to 1700 megahertz volt. Much higher than any of those stone circles. Four times as high. And you go between the two. This runs horizontally. The 1700 megahertz volt electromagnetic wave runs horizontally, create a dome-shaped effect. Once again, you can't get GPS reading inside the calendar. You go between the calendar stones, it shoots up to 1800 megahertz volt, but what does it do? It runs vertically, column of energy out of the ground, straight into the sky. So out of this dome-shaped effect of electromagnetic energy, you get this column of electromagnetic energy that runs straight into the sky. Looks something like this. That's what you're looking at. So when the psychics and the energy feelers and these clever people that connect to higher knowledge started telling me 5 years ago that this is an active vortex, an active portal, a transmutation device, a stargate, they're telling me all these things, I thought, okay, well, I'm an open-minded kind of guy, I'll listen to that, you know. Put it into file 13 and try and compute it when I have more information, and I now have more information. So I'm telling you that this is what they were feeling energetically. What is happening there? We truly have stumbled upon an ancient transmutation device, if you want to call it that. Or a stargate, or a portal. And what were they transmutating? What were they teleporting? Beam up the gold, Scotty. That's what I believe it's all about. They brought the gold from all over the place, put it between the stones, said, where do you want it? If Star Trek can do it with people and with other things, we've just found the real McCoy right here on Earth. Enki's calendar. Because that's what it's all about. It's about the gold. Just recently I found this interesting stone there. It looks like a normal stone. It's actually a hematite. From the one side it looks like a normal stone. When you turn it around, it's got this spectacular shiny silvery effect. It's known as botryoidal hematite. The only problem is that it's completely out of place, right there inside the Adam's calendar structure. It must have undergone some extreme conditions for it to transmutate into this. It doesn't belong there. So I'm suggesting that maybe it's an accidental remnant of some leak of energy from inside the two calendar stones that accidentally converted this hematite into this botryoidal hematite with a transmutated form over here. That's just a suggestion. So we get to the end of this presentation, in the last few minutes, we need to talk about what have we learned from all this. It's really, just a bunch of information, some interesting stories about origins of humankind. Some of this sounds a little bit far-fetched, some of it sounds really interesting and exciting and pushes our ability to test ourselves. But what do we do with this information? I believe that we're reaching the conclusion of a prophecy. All the ancient cultures keep telling us that the end days will be as the first days, as above, so below. We are learning things today that really boggle our mind. We're rediscovering free energy, and I must tell you that one of these devices, I have absolutely no reason to doubt the psychic that shared this with me, only one of these devices was capable, and is probably still capable, of giving us more energy than all the power plants on Earth active today. I'm just leaving that with you. Do with that what you want. So we have free energy coming out of our ears. All we have to do is figure out how to use these sound frequencies that are coming out of these stone circles. And if Tesla was here, we could do it like this. And I bet there are thousands, if not millions, of scientists out there that know how to do it, but they probably fear for their lives. So we're going to help them come out of the closet. We're crossing the galactic plane. We are in 2012, after all. We're seeing the rise and fall of civilizations in these large 26,000 year cycles. This giant spiral that our solar system is on, this orbit that it follows, that it crosses that galactic plane every 13,000 years, and every 26,000 years it completes it, and it seems that we're in that giant end of that cycle. That's where we were 3,000 years ago, 3,000 BC, and here we are. Just about to pop right over that thing. Well, what does that mean? It means very densely condensed information of light, energies, the source of all things. After all ancient cultures referred to the galactic core as the great sun from whence all life comes. And they were absolutely right. All of the solar systems that operate outside, around that central galactic core, are there only because of the great sun in the center. So we are crossing that horizon, that galactic plane, and we're being activated by it. It's raising our levels of consciousness, and I'll point you to the presentation in that UFO Science and Consciousness DVD that's lying over there. One of 14 international speakers, William Brown, one of the world's new bright shining lights in genetics and molecular biology, will show you in his presentation how we can show through genetics today how our DNA is being activated by this cosmic light that we are currently crossing. It is spectacular information. It is complete, sitting on the edge of your seat going, oh my God, I've always heard about it from the psychics and these woo-woo people. Now I'm hearing about it from a geneticist. We're like a walking receptor through our DNA in every cell of our body, every nucleus of every cell on the skin of our body is like a receptor and a transmitter to the galaxy. All the information that we have the ability to plug into, to rise in consciousness. It's activating our so-called junk DNA, which is actually the important part of our DNA. The 3% we use is there to control us. That was used to create us and keep us dumbed down. Now we're activating the real McCoy, that real stuff. It's going to make us explode with consciousness and start to reunite as thinking, clear thinking individuals and beings of higher consciousness. We're moving into higher consciousness, which means with knowledge, doesn't it? After all, that's what it's all about, with knowledge. And we're, through this consciousness, able to reconnect and tap into this morphogenic field that we're all part of and as a result of. And being able to tap into all this knowledge and information at any time and at all the time. But where do we go from here? What do we do with all this knowledge? Because the current situation is really not very good. Humans everywhere live in misery. There seem to be no happy outcome to the political and economic mess of the planet, and every year it gets harder for people to survive, chasing the buck, paying more for this, paying more for that, and earning less, keeping several jobs just so you can pay for bread, milk, and electricity. The global economic system is on the verge of collapse. Most economists don't even understand how it's still alive and how it's still going. And they keep predicting this giant collapse all the time. The reason I'm bringing this up, and this is not about getting political, people. I've had some people come to me after various presentations, say, oh, I love your presentation, but why do you get so political at the end? Says, buddy, you missed the whole point. It's not about getting political. It's about our human integrity. It's about our human rights. It's about everything that we've been denied of through manipulation. It's about our freedom, our humanness, and the rise of consciousness. So I bring this up because if we don't start talking about this now, and we do have a collapse, whether it's an external collapse through a solar flare or a giant comet or something that wipes everything out and shuts down the banking industry, if we wake up in a moneyless society tomorrow, what do we do? How do we work? How do we operate? How do we relate to each other? Do we kill each other for a slice of bread? Do we kill each other for a little bit of water? Only way to survive is by thinking about it and figuring out how we move into this through unity consciousness. Because if you see that what's going on in the world, that one third of the world's food goes to waste, it makes you sick. It makes you think, how did we get to this point? We're a sick species and we can do this to the other beings on this planet. How did it get so bad? The answers are simple. Every socio-political system we've had has failed us. Every single one of them. Why? Because it was based on money. Every single one of them. We also know that a small group of royal political elite are in control of the world. You can call them the secret societies, you can call them the royal political bloodline, call them what you want. When did this happen? When did they come into control? Well, the Sumerian tablets tell us very clearly when they got control of this planet. When kingdom was lowered to earth from heaven. Over and over again, they tell us. When kings were appointed and high priests were appointed. When they were given this advanced knowledge to use in secrecy against us, to enslave us. It's that simple. It's not wild, crazy talk. It's clear, clear-cut historic events. And it seems to have started, that information was given to us by the Sumerians. And it was also at this time that money was introduced, and I say here maliciously introduced, as a tool of enslavement against humanity. The origins of money once again go back to the Sumerians in the form of clay tablets. There were little tokens for exchange of things. For one of these you could get a bale of hay, you could get a goat, you can get that. Slowly but surely it became minted money. Money is not the consequence of natural evolution, as we are led to believe. You know, that's what they teach you at school. Oh, money is just a natural form of progress and evolution. That's a lie. Money was maliciously introduced by the kings and those that ruled over humanity during the Sumerian period as a form of absolute control, and that continues today. And every time you bring money into the system or into the equation, great minds of the past rise up against it. And every time they rise up against it, they seem to meet a very unhappy ending, like Julius Caesar, who gave dignity and prosperity to Rome, and after he was assassinated, it fell back into disorder and the bankers and the money changers took control. Jeshua, Jesus, Isa, call him what you want, in the last year of his life, probably the only time he showed physical violence when he turned against the money changers in the temple. And you see, money brings out some really interesting actions by guys. This Thomas Aquinas in 1225 stood up against the charging of interest onto money. He says it was a double charge. And he called it was actually the church law in the Middle Ages. Europe forbade the charging of interest on loans and even made it a crime called usury. And we know that term is still used today, don't we?
We sure do.
And then this most famous quote by Thomas Jefferson in recent times, I believe that banking institutions are more dangerous to our liberties than standing armies. If the American people ever allow private banks to control the issuer of their currency, first by inflation, then by deflation, the banks and corporations that will grow up around the banks will deprive the people of all property until their children wake up homeless on the continent their fathers conquered. Welcome to today. Here we are. Thomas Jefferson saw it coming. This is the day that we have to stand up, wake up, smell the coffee. This is where we are. My children are being born homeless. What do we do when it all collapses? The only way we can survive this, if and when it collapses, is to stand united. We have to overcome the divided society that we've become, and it's the divided society that's been enforced on us by the leaders. It's through fear that they keep us divided. Fear is the main tactic that they use, people. Just think about it. Every time you watch the news, every time you read the papers, every bit of information is all about fear. Division through fear. Fear of death, fear of cancer, fear of your neighbor, fear of a vicious dog, fear of getting an accident in the traffic, fear of losing your job, fear of being homeless, fear of bloody everything. It's insane. That is such a perfect tool of control, it's incredible. What's the worst thing that can happen? What's the worst thing? Come on.
You die.
You're going to die. So what? We're all going to die. If I die right now, if I die 20 years from now, who gives a shit? Quite frankly. You'll remember this and you'll talk about it maybe for a week. Who knows? But eventually, you know, I'm looking forward to the other side. So you know what? If that's the worst thing that can happen, let me help you. I'll help you pull that trigger. And maybe create a martyr. Who knows? So, stop living in fear. Worst thing that can happen is you're going to die. So, the exciting thing is that the solutions are really simple. All of you know what the solutions are. You know what the government should be doing. You know what your politicians should be doing. You have all the answers. Why is it that they find it so really difficult to find the answers and the solutions to the problems? And there's always some insurmountable problem that they just can't lay their hand on. Or just something always goes wrong with these people that we put in charge to be our servants. We have the answers. They are simple. I must remind you of your inalienable rights. And this I take from the Freedom Charter of the ANC, Nelson Mandela's party. It took him to becoming the president in South Africa. This is what they fought for and stood for decades. This is the Freedom Charter that, incidentally, I'm reintroducing into the Ubuntu movement in South Africa. And this is what it says. By the way, the current government in South Africa is far, far removed from this. They have desecrated the Freedom Charter that got them into the power. The country belongs to its people. The land belongs to its people. The water, the minerals, the airwaves, the air, the forests belong to the people. We have appointed our leaders to do the best for us, the people, to be the servant of the people. The servant of the people. Is that what's happening around the world today? Are the governments the servant of the people? Not on your life. What do people need? People need food, water, love, friendship, home, tables, chairs, knives, forks, gardens, clothes, technology, healthcare, arts, culture, everything you can imagine and everything you have not imagined yet. We need it, we want it, we should have it anytime, all the time. Because that's our right. It sounds weird, because we're not used to that kind of talk. Everything is scarce. We've been immersed and dumped into a world of scarcity and this shining little glimmer of hope that maybe one day I can get to the top of the pile and I can be in charge and I can rule and I can have more than everybody else. Well, that's the problem. Competition is the problem. Competition is the odd thing out. Competition goes against the law of nature. Competition is nothing but a con. Unity is what we need, not competition.